Hello again, everybody. Coming back to you again today because I wanted to talk about part two of the bushcraft community conversation I had earlier. And I know I got a little bit off the beaten trail in the conversation, but I want to talk to you about just some observations I see. You know, I follow a lot of different people in the bushcraft community. I also give courses myself, and I've sold bushcraft material for many years, actually, now. And it's the direction that I prefer than the tactical market, this kind of stuff. But one thing I've noticed is I've seen a lot of videos of guys, like I said, you know, carrying kit out into the forest that, you know, it looks so brand new that I wonder, are they really using this stuff? Are they really testing it? You know, I have, this is one of my small axes right here, okay? And, you know, I keep it up, you know, I use it quite often. It has a few, you know, it's quite sharp still, you know? I use it quite often, you know, this kind of stuff like that, and it's been used. I've had this axe right here for around 15 years now. All my axes are around the same age, it's around the same age. You can see in the sheath, this kind of stuff. It's not, I treat it, this kind of stuff, but I don't do this. Now, this right here is the one I use the least. It's probably, and this right here is probably been abused the most because I've lent it out. And this is the longer axe right here. Now, my axes are all from Grandsville Brooks, actually, the ones that I use and that I like to use. This is also this is it right here, yeah. And they get around. Now I've got the one I carry with me the most is a medium size axe, and it's right here. But it has been, the handle has been abused, just been hit a few times by other people I've lent it to. You know, they just haven't, you know, and I lent it to them while I'm out in the field with them, you know, on courses and stuff. But I got cleaned up a little bit because the last time I used it, which was just not too long ago, it got a little bit damp. But I need to take, it's easy to take some of the rust off of it and clean it up a little bit. I need to do a little better job of this one right here, but this is one I use the most. I mean, I really like this size, this axe right here. It's a good axe, and it'll be a good fighting axe also if you need to fight with it. But hopefully that never has to happen, you know. But I use a lot of, you know, different, I don't use a whole lot of different equipment, but I use a lot of stuff for a long time. I don't buy a lot of new stuff, you know. I do have a look at a lot of new stuff and test a bit of it, but I don't necessarily use it, you know. And I am someone who prefers, once I find something I like a lot, I tend to use it. Like I said, you know, when it comes to backpacks, my main backpack for winter and for week long, things, you know, is my, I have actually a U.S. Marine Corps FIBLE. It's, the U.S. Marine Corps main rucksack, but I have only the main part and I have four large pockets on it, and it blends in really well with nature. It's a coyote color. But it's very comfortable to carry stuff. You know, it's really comfortable, and it has a good volume to it, probably about 100 liters. The pack I use on lightweight camping and hiking trips during the summer is a Granite gear pack. I think it's what it is, a Granite gear pack, and I really like it. It's a lightweight pack, but very, very comfortable, and I can get everything I need in it, you know. And then I have my summer packs. I have a Camelback pack, which I don't like Camelback bladders. That's the first thing I do, is I rip those out. If I find a bag I like, it happened to be Camelback. And I found one when I was with scouting, and I saw another boy using it. I was like, man, that's a nice pack, you know? So I found one myself and ripped the bladder out of it. But it's a really good everyday pack, and you can use it for city and for the field, actually, because it's well laid out. And I like that pack. It's about a 35 liter pack. But my normal field pack for daytime stuff is a Munro, and it's a really good pack. It's very simple, basic, you know. Nothing crazy. I do have some shoulder bags, but I tend to not use them too much for field stuff, except my fishing bag, which is a Babor, actually, and it has a liner that you can button into it. But I've actually used that actually even for work and stuff, to throw stuff in it, you know. And it's a really good compromise, but also it's a solid bag. But anyway, those are my primary, those are my bags actually that I use. You know, I mean, I like those bags. Those bags work for me, and I suggest you find something that works for you. Now, I've gone through a lot of bags in 35 years, you know, from the Army using Alice packs along with the Alpine Loa Commando pack, which I used during the Gulf War. And then afterwards, you know, I used an Alice for like a minute, and then I realized, you know what? I just didn't like it. It's not comfortable. So I switched over to a lot of the packs, testing them out, and everything from North Faces to Mammut to you name it, I've tried it. And I ended up with what I have now, and I'm pretty happy with them. You know, I do like Mystery Ranch packs. That's some of the best packs I've used also. Kifaru has a very good pack. But all the Kifaru packs I seem to have gotten, I sold them off to somebody else. I just didn't like them in the end. I mean, they're great packs. It just didn't fit what I wanted to do with it, you know. After packs, we're talking about what do you put in it. You know, I'm a waterproof. I put every, you know, people always come to me and say, hey, I need a waterproof cover for my backpacks. And well, I don't know what you need, or waterproof bags to put all your stuff in. You know, your pack, you know, it's going to get wet no matter what you do. Now, if you have no other, I mean, it's good to have one maybe to protect it or for camouflage or something like that, you know, but I don't necessarily use one. You know, I'll throw my poncho over it if I have to, just give it a little bit extra, or my bash over, just get a little bit extra protection. But everything in it is inside waterproof bags and that kind of stuff. From my sleeping bag, which is the Army ECWC Gore-Tex bag with the black winter and the green lightweight bag, and a stuff bag. I use that because that's a large bag, and I'm a large guy, and I can easily get in it and feel very comfortable. Now, I have tried the Defense 4 and the Trooping bags, which I love. I love those bags. I'm just not able to get into them and be comfortable. They're just a little bit too tight for me across the shoulders. And I really like those bags a lot, you know. There are some of the bags out there not so expensive, you know. But anyway, but I see these people using these different, using this equipment. I see them showing these really great videos, this kind of stuff like that. I mean, and it's just like, their kit is just too new. And when you question about it, boy, they got all butthurt, you know, and they get all defensive, and they start to say, well, you know, I take care of my stuff. You know what? I take care of my stuff too, but other people also use it sometimes, and they bing it up, this kind of stuff. Do I need to change this handle? No. I've actually sanded it down. By the way, all these marks right here are from my dog. My dog actually was sitting, it was on my backpack, and in the back of my Land Rover Defender. And I threw Tex in the back, and he just decided he wanted to chew on it, you know, and he chewed on it. And I resanded it, and then I put more linseed oil on it, and it's been fine. It's a good bag. Now, yeah, I got this spot right here, it's been dinged somewhat, you know. Matter of fact, I brought it with me on a camp out, and a friend of mine cut his toe open because he didn't follow the, you know, I tried to explain to him how to cut with an axe, and since he didn't follow my rules or didn't follow the rules, you know, but he paid for it, and he learned something from us. One thing, I ended up having to get him first aid that night. Good first aid kit's also important, and people tend to go with the minimum of stuff. You know, I'm not saying you got to carry a monster medical bag with you with IVs, that kind of stuff like that, but at least have a little bit of trauma and no first aid. You need to take some first aid courses, you know. When it comes to your knife, like I said, and I've gotten a lot of feedback from there, my father used to say a knife that's not sharp is called a stick. So make sure you got a good sharp knife. Do you have to sharpen it 24/7? No. Once you've put in a really good edge on it, it'll hold on to that edge. Just don't beat it up. Don't hit rocks with it. Don't hit metal, you know. And you can strump it on some leather to renew, to take those burrs out. So what happens is your knife, you sharpen it, it has a little bit of metal that folds over that last bite. And to remove that, you need to pull the blade away. And you can do that with leather. You can do it with rubber. I've seen people use carton, paper, cardboard, and also to finish up even the edge of a window I've seen, on the window of a car, you know, just roll the window down a little bit and then pull that across it, you know, 10 or 15 times and it cleans it up. These are things, you know, that's why I carry a leather belt and I keep my knives in a leather pouch because of that, because I just want to keep it that way. You know, I've used, when I took the Red Mares course, they all gave us a mortar, a basic mortar knife. And a lot of people broke them, you know, they broke the handles or they broke the, because it's not a full tang knife. So get you a good full tang knife. I suggest, if you're going to invest in these, you know, start off small. Don't invest too much in the very beginning. Get you a mortar, try it out, you know, or one of the mortar has some good quality full tang versions. Those are great knives, you know. They're really good knives. High carbon steel, they'll allow you to use with flint or also with your ferrocene rod. Don't get these combat, you know, knives, and all these blackened knives, you know, because the problem is that black on it doesn't allow you to really use that ferrocene rod, you know. Just get you just a regular knife. Plus, if you drop it at night, you're not going to be able to find it. It's good to have a shiny blade. I keep mine shiny and clean, and that's how I keep mine. That's just, you do the same, you know. Keep your knife clean, you know, because, you know, you're going to cut through meat, it's kind of like that with it. Don't use products on it that are toxic, you know. You can use a little bit of olive oil on it, but don't drip it off. You know, just wipe it off. You know, and just have a very, very light coat that you would, same as you do with a rifle, something like that. You know, fire kit. I always carry a fire kit on me, and inside that fire kit, I have a little small tobacco tin, and inside of it, I have beeswax candles. I have my flint and steel. I have some char cloth in there. I have some hemp rope in it, cord in it. You know, I carry the fungi that you can use to light up this kind of stuff. So I carry these kind of things within it, you know, and I also throw in a lighter and some matches, you know, and that's along with the fire, with the kit. I also have a good magnifying glass, you know, that I can use to and that's actually built into my kit. Also within my, and I keep it in a possibles pouch. I can put it on my pocket, on my belt, throw it in a pocket, put it in my pack. I often, when I'm hiking, I keep it, just keep it in the pack, you know. And if I'm running around, I could put it on my belt, but it depends on the comfort level, you know, what I'm doing exactly. But within that, I keep my Swiss Army pocket knife, along with a headlamp. I use a Petzl headlamp, 350 lumens, with spare batteries. And I throw in, I can't remember everything I put in there. I could go get it real quick. But and I put in other bits and bobs in there for a possibles pouch, you know. And you can even throw a little bit of food in there if you want to, like a little snack or something. But yeah, I have that. I can't remember what I have in there actually. I also throw some 550 cord in there, you know, some stuff like this. A really lightweight pouch. I can, if I have to leave my main pack, I can leave with that along with my knife, and I'm okay still. You know, I carry the 10 essentials, and we spoke about that already, you know, within the 10 essentials, you know, I think that it's one of those things that, I think it's one of those things that we have to pay close attention to. I also talk about these things with my scouts, that counts everything from, you know, it depends on what you're doing, you know. Back in the day, when I worked in Geneva, I worked with UNHCR, and I helped develop a run bag with them and a main living bag, basically. One was a run bag, which is about 35 liters that he could carry with him anywhere and everywhere. And it had the 10 essentials plus a few other things that myself and the director of this organization within the UNHCR who were sent out on missions. There were about 8 individuals. They were sent, like, for example, with the earthquake in Nepal, they quickly sent teams out there And I got some good feedback from them telling me that the kit that I came out with was really good. Now, these kits were not for free. Huh? I mean, it had a really good two-man tent in each bag, which were only a couple hundred grams more than a one-man tent. Gave more space with a vestibule. A really good extreme cold weather sleeping bag system. And that we supply them with a Gore-Tex cover and the Defense One and Troopin sleeping bag. Or the ECC, which is basically like a Defense One sleeping bag, but it also came with a down sleeping bag that you could put on the inside. And what happens that down was on the inside, it would absorb your humidity, but the synthetic on the outside would pull that humidity out also. And of course, they had ration packs, they had clothing that they would need, they had wash kits that they would need. They had everything inside these main big pack that they would need to transport up there. And then they had their small run packs that they would carry in their vehicles to carry them at all time. And inside that was basic tent essentials with some extra survival gear, snuggy gear, this kind of stuff, and of course food. Now those guys, sometimes in some areas, some of them went actually tooled up. So it also complemented that, you know. But you need to carry the proper clothing with you, you know. I'm going to go over a quick list. I'm actually looking online here, and you need to have the proper kind of clothing with you for depends on the weather. You know, I always carry a little lightweight insulated stuff with me, extra socks, you know, some gloves, this kind of stuff like that. Water bottle with with water tabs, a headlamp with extra batteries. You know, toiletry kit, and that's quite a small micro kit that I've come up with basic like travel stuff in it, you know, travel liquid soap, this kind of stuff, just in case you need it. Because depending on what you're going to do, you know, if you're just lightweight hiking across Europe, it's nice to have these essentials with you also, you know. And of course, map and compass, pen and paper, some you know, lightweight hiking food. Now, you know, this the thing about the kit that I've come up with, it's not, I didn't come up with it. It already existed. I've just compiled what works best for me. And here they get a 12 essentials for hiking. Let's see. Closed-toed shoes, full stop. Okay. So I'm already wearing that. Okay. Tall socks, duh. You say I'm already wearing socks. Of course I'm wearing socks. Well, you throw an extra pair in there and make sure that they're not cotton. Cotton kills, we used to say. Backpack, of course you need a backpack. A backpack of the proper size. You don't need to carry a 100-liter one, but you don't need to carry exactly, you know, exactly what you need. You need to have a little bit of space to breathe, you know. I've been on trips before where suddenly things change. I said, you know what, I need to, you know, to add or subtract, you know. And you never, I don't subtract stuff from my pack, but I sure have added stuff to it, you know. And with your first aid kit, you got bug spray, you got, any kind of special meds you may need. On top of that, sun cream, crumb lotion, sunglasses, proper headgear. You know, if you wear eyewear, you know, I suggest you bring a second pair with you. You know, I need it for reading because I just can't see so well anymore. I'm 52 years old, and since I was 40, it started going a little bit downhill. And these are actually prescription, so I actually see much better. I don't know if my eyes look like they're 500 times bigger, you know, but anyway. So these are some of the things, and you can actually, believe it or not, you look at the Boy Scouts of America. I'm going to go online here. The Boy Scouts of America. Ten essentials for camping. And it's one of the best ones I've ever seen, actually. Let's see if I can come up, if I can see this. Let's see. Here we go. It's actually 10 essentials on Wikipedia. You know, it's actually pretty good. Navigation, map, altimeter, compass, GPS device, personal locator beacon. Sometimes in some places you may need this, you know, even if you're carrying also your telephone, but I suggest, you know, learn a map, learn how to use a map and compass, get you the right material and carry it with you along with a notepad and a paper and a pen. Okay. Headlamp with extra bulbs. You know, not extra bulbs, they're all LED. A good strong headlamp, 350 lumens is really good with extra batteries. Sun protection. Okay, this all goes with within your first aid kit. A good first aid kit inside a waterproof bag. Okay, make sure your stuff's inside waterproof bags because they can be ruined. Actually, a knife. You know, I carry a fixed blade knife on me, but if I'm going hiking, I can, I'll throw it inside the backpack so I'm not wearing it on my hip. But I also carry my little, you carry a multi-tool. Although I used to have a really good, the Leatherman Wave, that was a really lightweight, really good multi-tool, actually. I can definitely, if you, the problem is you can't find them, they stop making them. You know, fire kit, you know, shelter, you know, even if it's garbage bags, but, you know, get yourself a basha or a poncho, because a poncho you can use, you can tie the head up for you, make it as a tarp, or you can, with parachute cord. And what I do is I actually rig my tarp before I go out. It's already rigged, okay? I'm going to do a really intensive, once I get settled in when I moved, or maybe next weekend, I'm going camping next weekend normally, and maybe I'll make some videos out there, actually, and I'll give you an idea. Extra food. It's always good to have extra food, you know, extra water with filter, even the micro pure tablets or iodine, this kind of stuff, and some extra clothing. These are all good things to make sure you have with you, okay? These things right here. There are a few other things I always suggest, you know, I mean, bring you some toilet paper, and I have people say, well, I only bring us a little bit of toilet paper. You know what? Bring you some toilet paper. Now, if you're up next to a creek somewhere, you can get you some water. You can clean yourself up with some water a proper distance, you know, a good 50 meters to 80 meters away from the creek, I would suggest, or the water source. Do your due, make sure you bear it, clean yourself really good, really well, you know, and that's a good way to do it. Even use soap and water, because what happens if you clean yourself off with just water, sometimes you're going to, it's going to dry up a little bit. When it dries, it can become quite frictionless down there, and the last thing you want is a case of monkey butt, we called it, or over here they call it the loo, the wolf, you know, because you're running around, which it's not very nice, it's not very nice. But these are some of the things. Now, getting back to the point that I was speaking out before, people making these videos and showing a crazy amount of kit that they're carrying with them. Now, look, carry your essentials, carry what you need, carry all that you need. But remember, you know, the more that you carry, the heavier it's going to get, okay? But if I see a video of somebody carrying 5 knives, but they don't have a good first aid kit, I'm like, what the hell are they thinking about here, you know? Why do you need 5 knives? You know, or 2 different saws, or it's just, yeah, carry 5 good tools with you, you know, and I spoke about that already, you know, a good fixed blade saw, a good fixed blade knife, a handsaw, an axe, a curved blade for making spoons and bowls, this kind of stuff like that, and if you don't know how, you need to learn to do that, and if I carry my spare, if you carry a Leatherman or a Swiss Army knife on it, you'll have an auger, an awl. That's basically a big needle. You can pierce through bark, you can pierce through leather or whatever material, and you can sew it up with either string or with plant matter, you know, like that you can make out of cordage, you know. So these are some of the things I suggest, you know. Do what you got to do in the end of the day. I'm not saying you have to do this kind of stuff. I just suggest that you pay attention to this kind of stuff, you know. And I just see, like, ultralight hikers, they're the ones whom I see end up having usually the weirdest stories, you know, or the worst stories, because they just tend to be some of the least qualified people to go into the woods, I find sometimes, you know. They just tend to not take what they need, you know. And because they're looking for the ultimate, you know, just because, you know, every time I come back from hiking, I lay my gear out. Before I go hiking, I lay my gear out and I pack it up and I make sure it's the right fit, and I go hiking. I come back, I unpack everything first for several reasons. The first reason, to make sure that it's all accounted for. Okay, did I lose something? You know, do I have everything? And I usually take a picture before I leave, so I have an idea. But also, did I use it or did I not use it? And if I used it, why? And if I didn't use it, why did I not use it, okay? And is it something that did I really need? Did it work out well? Did it work well? Or did I, you know, or do I, or can I put it aside and I don't really need it for the next time? And also check if things have been broken or something like that. Because, I mean, sometimes I have a tarp or something like that. I noticed the last time I was camping, I had this lightweight tarp and I had lots of little small holes in it, you know. And I said, well, I'm gonna go back to my original tarp, which it's not any heavier. It's about the same weight, and it's a little bit bigger, a little bulkier, you know. But it's a really good. It's the Australian Army their camouflage Basha tarp, you know, really good, really good. But what I do is I already go ahead and I have the main line, ridge line built on it, and I have Prusik knots from the tarp onto that, and then I fold it all up together, and I put all the string inside of it, and I roll it all up, and I have all the tent stake lines already also rolled up into. So when I get there, I can if it's raining and pouring, I can tie it up to one tree, tie the other tree up. It never touches the ground. I can spread it out real quick, quickly do the four corners, and then do the middle ones if I need it, and then I have a space there that I can immediately start working under, you know, and pull my kit out, you know, that I need for my sleeping kit, this kind of stuff, you know. So one thing I don't do is I don't leave my sleeping kit out all day. I will take my sleeping bag and lay it in the sunlight over my tarp or something like that, or over a limb or something like that, over a bush like that, so it can dry out. I don't leave it out all day, though. I'll leave it out just for an hour or so while I'm eating breakfast or during that morning, and then I'll take it and I'll fold it back up and I'll put it back in the my wet weather bag. About an hour before I go to sleep, I'll pull it all out, let it breathe, let it open up, this kind of stuff. That way it's all ready for when I want to get inside of it, you know. Another thing I also do at night is in the evening I also make sure I have my Petzl light around my neck or in a pocket somewhere I can get to it real quick if I need it, because sometimes the dark hits really hard, you know, very quickly. But anyway, getting back to what I see in these videos, you know, I hate to see it because these are not bad guys. They just are over. Someone's been preaching this kind of stuff, you know. And although I do like the Pathfinder school from what I'm seeing of it and the teachings that's going with it, it seems like it's pretty straightforward, more of a survival thing, but it's also puts you in a situation where you're really living off less, you know. I like that. As a matter of fact, I wouldn't mind attending the basic course to check it out, you know, but it's in the States. I live over here in Europe, you know. I do follow those guys. I've been following David Canterbury since the beginning. I did not like him at all in all these videos and this kind of stuff. And I did see where his house burned down last year or year before last. I really hope that he and his wife are able to get into a new house soon. And it seems like his courses haven't slowed up or stopped either. He's still at it, you know, and I gave him a lot of, you know, of course there was that controversy over him, which I didn't like at all. But you know what? The guy showed balls and he came in and he apologized for it and we move on. I did see him at one time, you know, he talks about the five C's, this kind of stuff, and I think that's a great idea. You know, I do like it. You know, I like what I see coming out of there, you know. But what I see is a lot of these people who've taken these courses or follow him, they seem to be coming out a little bit too gung-ho when it comes to what they carry, you know. One thing that does bother me a little bit when I see that is that it's really a big marketing pitch also for his company, for his equipment, that kind of stuff. And I remember back in the day when he was making videos of him hunting hogs in the Florida Everglades and this kind of stuff, that was a much more interesting program coming out of him. I mean, he was really getting out there and doing it, and I really liked it. And he was using stuff that was just in the market, you know. And now he's sort of making this kind of stuff and living under these beefed up survival blankets, this kind of stuff. I don't know. You know what? I have been out camping in the winter here in Switzerland, where it gets minus 12 degrees up on the Jura, in just a couple of blankets, and with a long fire, you know, under a shelter that I built myself. And I even carry a cotton waterproof tarp with me that I can fold over that. It was cold, you know, it was very cold. I prefer a sleeping bag or even less a poncho iron. These blankets are very heavy. They work. You know, I keep blankets in my car, wool blankets always in my truck. And I keep some here at the house. I have them right in here. They itchy and scratchy though. But the Swiss ones aren't very long. They're like 1.80 meters, really short, you know, when you throw your feet and that kind of stuff in there. So they come down to about the middle of your chest, sadly, you know. But I do have some other ones that are a bit longer. But they're great for winter because even if they're wet, they work really well. But I do prefer something else. Listen, I'm going to cut this short right here real quick, and we'll talk about a part three later on. But I just want to get that out there and just tell you, just you know, stick to the basics. And anytime you know, that you do something, go back to the basics. It's the basics that's going to get you through, okay? It's not all this advanced crazy stuff, you know? I mean, I've trained with people who they watch movies and they think they got to go out there and do this and do that. I said, no, you don't need to do this and do that. You know, I mean, I'm 52 years old. I don't want to go out there and survive. I know how to do it, but I sure as hell don't want to have to, okay? But if I'm going out there, I want to enjoy myself. I want to be comfortable when I sleep. I want to eat right. And I want to enjoy my time out there. I don't go to the forest to suffer. I go out there to enjoy myself. But if it comes to the point to where, you know, you have to survive, the more you know, and if you have the right kind of kit with you at all times, you can go from survive to thrive. And that's the goal. Anyway, listen, this is the end of part two. I hope to get back with you again soon. Like, comment, and subscribe if you like my videos. If you don't, I do apologize. You know, they're not for everybody, I guess. But I do hope that you enjoy this video. And if you have any questions, please comment below. Anyway, you guys have a happy Saturday. I'll talk to you again soon. Goodbye.